Hey guys, welcome back to another episode, and even working on a weekend, so I'm super happy to have half the Biz Bros on the show today. So it should be, I don't know if it's Biz or the Bro that's on. So yeah, lovely to have Louise on the show. They do the awesome show Content is Profit, where I don't know if you ever watched it, is the most energetic, and I really love what they do. They just bring energy from, it doesn't matter what mood you're in, just joining them, it just lifts your spirits and just gets you feeling a lot better. So yeah, I love that. Yeah, backstage we're talking about some football, so keen to hear about that. So I'd love to welcome Louise, and please share with us something you believe online entrepreneurs should stop doing in order to grow to the next level.
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, thank you so much for having me on the show. It's a pleasure to be here. What should they stop doing? They should stop chasing the shiny object. So that stopped us, and for a long time, and it was about like 4 years that we were just chasing different opportunities without really diving in into one, right? And when we decided, or when we got slapped in the face by, you know, our mentors and our coaches, we're like, you guys have to focus in one thing. That's when we really started getting a lot of results, right? We were going from funnels to content to email marketing to all these things, right? Because we were victims of that marketing message that sometimes we see online way too much, and it was crazy. We couldn't scale, we couldn't get the results for our clients that we wanted to, even though sometimes we did get results, but it was really challenging. And I don't like to say we wasted, but you know, we spent like 4 years, you know, figure that one out. You know, I believe that was part of our journey, but if it's something that, you know, we can relate to the next generation, I guess, and we're still growing, right? We're still going through those things, but is stay focused, right? Pick that one thing and just go really deep. And then after that, you can diversify a little bit.
Yeah, it's funny you say that. I mean, even with myself, you go through your feed and you see a guy that had 100K day and a million, you know, dollar day, and you're like, man, should I be in that, or should I be, you know? So I think everybody, I mean, even the top guys are still saying, you know, they deal with that on a daily basis, just to realize that there are other opportunities out there. But each opportunity has its own opportunity to make so much success out of, you know. So I think, you know, your background is interesting. I mean, I love the bio where it says, you know, you and your brother used to fight and now you work together. So it's like, I think that's where all brothers come from. So what is a bit of that story, just so people can relate more to where you came from and kind of where you're going with Content is Profit in that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we are from Venezuela, right? So we grew up in there. Our dream was always to play professional soccer or football, right? Like the real football. And that was like everything that we did, right? Like every decision that we made in the weekends was because we had a game the next day and we got to stay in and we sleep and discipline. And our dad came from a military background. So he was like very, very strict on these things. We also like to have a lot of fun, right? But the priority was that, right? So we got the chance to play in Europe for a couple of years. And that's ultimately what led to come to the United States and play on a soccer scholarship here, both of us. Like, he started in Texas, I ended up in Florida. And that's what caused for us to stay here. But, you know, as we grew, we were never really too close, right? We were about 3 years apart. So that difference, you know, we had different group of friends, it is noticeable. And we never thought that we were actually going to do something together, right? Like, we were brothers, we will hang out. But anyway, so when we migrate to the States, right, he comes from Texas to Florida. And then when we're here, for me, that was it. Like, the dream was over. Like, I decided I don't want to chase this anymore. That was my decision for different reasons. That's like a whole new episode. And then Fonzie came to Florida, and he was actually in the professional soccer team here in Jacksonville, Florida, where we're from. And but then paperwork got in the way and he was not able to play, right? So for him was more of a very intense moment when we realized, hey, that this is it. Now what, right? Like, and we started sitting, thinking about what are the next steps for us, you know, either our careers or things. And I was never attracted by going to a big company and work, right? Like, around where we are, there's a lot of financial logistics kind of things. I still think that that's so boring. It's so needed, but it's so boring. And I was like, I'm not the person for that. And I don't want to be miserable, right? So I kept taking different jobs that allowed me to have a lot of time to develop what became Biz Bros, right? So that's when we started. We ended up investing about $1,000 in a social media marketing course that allowed us to give us like some tools to go out there and start selling. And that's how everything started. We dabbled with stickers. Screen printing from the garage of the house. So those are like the initial ventures, right? And then from there, we started listening a lot to the market. And we're like, oh, we need this. And we're like, we can do that, right? We used to, about 4 years ago, we used to market ourselves as the anti-marketing agency, right? We will go out to the small businesses and we were like, hey, by the way, like, are you happy with the current marketing agency, right? Normally small businesses, because the owner is the operator in many cases, right? They're so in the business that everything that comes from outside is noise. It's really challenging for them to make an educated decision, right? So we will say, hey, and we noticed this after starting working with them, but our pitch was like, you're not happy with this. We can do it better. We can do it differently, right? And then they will hire us and we'll go immediately to Google or YouTube, like, how do you do this? And then we'll implement at the same time. So they knew that we were starting, this was a new opportunity. But it costs, like, for some relationships, it costs a lot of friction, right? So I don't recommend that personally. we had this term table phase. We did learn a lot. We had amazing friends that we knew around the time, and it helped us evolve. But then we quickly identify, maybe this is not the market, because it's creating a lot of friction in the process. In us trying to scale, we couldn't hire anybody because we're doing so many things. And that's when, we decided to focus on just one thing.
Yeah, I think the important thing is obviously when, most business owners are wearing, you'll know when you started, you were wearing 65 different hats. It's marketing and sales and, content and. So it's a different shift that, there's a lot of people that are helping the people start out with their business. But it's very difficult from there to help them start giving those hats out to say, listen, I know who to hire in terms of getting people so that you can do what you love and not spend time on the back end stuff.
Yeah. And that's still now, right? We help local businesses, right? Right now we're helping this fitness location and owner keeps coming in and we're like, hey, we're here to hire, you hired us to hire the rest of the staff so you can be away from the studios, right? So you could have your owner's life. And sometimes for us, when we're starting on our business, even though if we worked for a different company, that's exactly what it is. So you're right on the money right there. And I think that's one of the things that we got to recognize and be like, okay, how can I actually fire myself as fast as possible so this thing can grow?
How can I let my baby go to someone else? Yeah.
Yep.
I do feel a bit bad that I don't have sound effects for you. I need that keyboard of yours for this. So I feel a bit bad.
No worries. Oh, that's a funny story with the Rodecaster. We obviously have the show now. We're about like to hit 220 episodes. But when we first decided to do a show was about a year before we started Content is Profit, and we decided to do something called Brews and Bros. And the idea was to document a challenge that we were doing, right? Because all the coaches, everybody around in our world were like, you guys have to publish, right? You guys have to be out there, right? So we decided to do that. And I remember seeing the advertising for the machine that we have. And I'm like, I'm gonna invest this $800, right? And if I do that, my thought process was, if we do this, right, at the time there was no team, no nothing, right? We will do the show because it's such a big investment, right? For us at the time, it was such a big investment. And we did, and we bought the machine and we recorded like 5 episodes. It was a complete fiasco. Cameras like running out of time, beers over the computer. We were like, we need to stop this. This is not sustainable. We cannot produce it. There's a lot of friction. And then the machine stayed in a closet for about a year. Where, it stayed there just collecting dust. And then we decided to launch Content is Profit. And now it has been part of the brand, and apparently it's like their own character because people love it.
Yeah. It's got like its own brand to it. So that's awesome. In terms of, I think the biggest challenge that we're seeing out there is the constant question around content. People are asking about content. There's so many different views in terms of people are saying publish daily. Some people are saying don't publish daily, rather publish more quality instead of quantity. In terms of the people listening and from your perspective in terms of content, what do you see is working there, and what do you recommend kind of, let's say, from starting out to the more established guys that, that kind of have a bigger business?
Yeah, absolutely. We can go in so many directions over here, but I want you to think, like, we consume a lot of YouTube content, for example. Like, we're always consuming content to grab ideas and frameworks and different things, right? And we tried it all. We tried it, you know, 3 times a week. We tried to see at the data to see where people do that, and that those elements, like, created a lot of friction. We tried to do high quality with Bruce and Bros, right? We had 2 cameras, the lighting, all this stuff. And then we couldn't edit, right? So we started where we were the operators on the content, right? And we had to create where a lot of entrepreneurs, when they start their venture, because they have to wear so many hats, one of those hats is content. Well, guess what? That priority is probably not the highest, right? Because at first we need to create cash flow, right? To be able to get the resources to then reinvest in the system that we're creating. And the perception of a lot of people is that content is not going to bring them that right away, especially organic content, right? So we were in that same position, but then what we did is we flipped our perspective. That's number one. And we're like, okay, if I create, I need to create because everybody that's successful is creating. So, like, there has to be some gain, right? We saw that people up there were creating and they were recommending people to start publishing somehow, right? They don't tell you how. There's a ton of tactics, tons of things, right? But, like, you got to start creating. And we're like, oh, what does that mean? And then for us, the fact that we actually started with Facebook Lives. We just went on live for 45 days straight. We did a challenge called 45 Live internally for us. And after 15 days, we ended up in meeting this relationship that ended up being a 6-figure contract for us. And that kickstarted the whole thing. And we're like, wow, okay, what can we learn about this? Consistency, right? These guys saw us showing up every single day, right, for 15 days. And he reached out and be like, hey, I'm interested to have a conversation with you guys, right? And then that relationship is what created that. And we're like, huh, that's interesting. We didn't even have a show. We didn't do the multi-purposing at the time. Then we're like, okay, let's do a take two on Facebook Live, right? 45 Live season 2. And we did. And guess what? Around day 17, same thing happened. Somebody else reached out and it's like, I want to know more about you guys, what you do. Can you help me, right? And we're like, huh, consistency works, right? And then when we decided to launch the show, we're like, hey, let's take this to a whole new level. And just for perspective, with the show, we produce about 400 pieces of content every single month that go out in multiple platforms. And we're consistently pushing that to go higher. So we're high volume fans. Guess what? All the accounts go up, right? At a certain degree. We've been able to develop amazing relationships from the show itself. We haven't heard any negative comments, right? The algorithm is going to take care of that, right? If somebody doesn't like it, they're not going to show it to them, right? They're going to show it to the people that actually raise their hands and watch those videos. So we don't have to be worried about, like, what time do I post? So one of the points of friction that I personally had was figuring out, I don't want to do a whole research for a video that's going to take me like 5 hours to record very high quality, right? And then I post on YouTube, let's say, for example, and then I got to do another one. For me, there was a ton of work that I was not willing to do at the time. So I'm like, okay, how can I remove the friction? The priority is to publish, right? So how can I do this without having to do all that? So that's why we decided to go live, right? But again, everybody's going to have their own go-to. But for me, friction was doing the whole research. So I'm doing constantly, right? I continuously read books. I continually consume content. I continually have experiences. So my framework for creation was, I'm actually going to take one of those lessons that I learned today or something that happened to me, and then I'm going to relate it to my business on the back end, and I'm going to publish that. That was my simple framework for every 45 Live that we've done. And we've done 3 seasons. And then for the show, it's very similar. The show, we do interviews, and if we do a solo episode, it is a very similar framework, right? And after that, once you master, like, that your core publishing, there's some people that are really good on Instagram that really enjoy writing long captions. There's some people that really enjoy TikToks, right? We don't do TikToks. It's just because we are very comfortable in the medium that we are, and we enjoy it. We like it. So number one is figure out, if you are not creating, figure out, like, why you like to create. That's where you have to start, because if you're trying to figure out and adding a lot of friction for the other processes, it's never going to happen. It never happened for us for like 4 years. The example is the first podcast, right? We were there for 5 nights, and because it was so friction on the production, the setup took us about an hour. And then after that, we're like, oh man, do we have to edit all of this, right? What happens is, as you evolve, right, as you create those resources, as you create those opportunities to sell, because we have to sell, you're going to have resources to invest, right? So then you, your first hire might be an editor. Now you have more capacity, right? Now you can explore different things. Obviously, the content that we do now is not us, right? We just record and then the team takes care of it out of the framework. And then it's super fun because you can start testing different things. You'll be like, oh, what if we test, you know, TikTok? And we're about to, right? We're like, with the content of the show, we're like, let's see what happens, right? So I think that's step number one. Then step number two, what a lot of people forget at the very beginning is connecting that content to what they do. We did for many years, right? Many times. And it's like, okay, how I need to tell the people where to find me. I need to tell the people, like, this is what I do. This is how I serve, for them to raise their hands, right? And then we can dive into either like organic. How do we increase like the gas? But for us, it's all about the relationships. And that's why we have a show where we can develop those strategic relationships. Either they become clients, they become partnerships. We participate in different summits. Like, there's many, many opportunities that have happened since Content is Profit, you know, from being a client to speaking at a big event, for example, right? It will come to you. It's just, you got to get it out first. So how do we get it out first? Removing all the friction.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I mean, I think coming back to that answer, the problem that I think people starting out with is they feel they can't give any, you know, they can't publish anything because they don't know enough. But they're focusing on the wrong thing in terms of they're focusing on people that know more than them instead of showing people that know less than them what they've learned, if that makes sense. And, you know, the other thing, what I believe that Facebook Lives, this kind of, you know, scenario allows for people to see is they get to see you. They, you know, the written stuff is, you can hide a lot behind it. When it's Facebook Lives, when it's interviews, when it's podcasts, they get to know you, and that I think that's a deeper relationship as well. And also, you know, I mean, it's the same with the show. You started it to build relationships with people. That's very difficult over Messenger, over a post or something like that. But I mean, coming back to relationships, I mean, what kind of, you said the first relationship really opened a six-figure, you know, deal for you. I mean, what other relationships have formed? It's more just to show people on the show that, listen, once you get out there, by all means, I've got no perfect setup. I mean, you got a cool background, you got noises. Like, I don't even have a backdrop. But it's just about that people are not looking for your background. They just want the relationship and to see is there any combination of you know, skill set that can go forward. So it's just about teaching those people that you need to get out there and show your face and show who you really are.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we were having a conversation, yes, and, you know, to circle back a little bit to a point that you made earlier about showing up and that people see you, right? Sometimes it's not about the content that you're creating. Like, see it as reps, right? For everybody that played sports, right? Every single day you're out there practicing, right? For us, for football, we're passing the ball every single day, right? Like, so many reps, right? And if we want to get to a level, if you want to look at the people that we look up to, how many years have they been publishing, right? Like, I'm going to give you an example. We had a call with this lady, and they're in real estate, right? They have an incredible business, but they haven't published much. They haven't found their footing. They haven't found like what they really want to do. They haven't been able to find a way to monetize it with what they're doing. And she's like, because of the kids watch a lot of YouTube, their reference is Mr. Beast. And I don't know if you're familiar with Mr. Beast, but you're okay. Perfect. So he's one of the biggest YouTubers ever. I think they're about to hit 70 million subscribers, right? And when we ask her, hey, where do you want to go? Like, from here, like, what's your goal? It's like, I want to be the Mr. Beast of real estate, right? I'm like, okay, how long have you been publishing? And she's like, about a year. And I'm like, okay, well, Mr. Beast has been publishing for 9. That's one. And then also he gives out a lot of money. Like, he spends, we heard an interview the other day, about $4 million in every YouTube video, $4 million. In each YouTube video, right? So it's about perspective, right? It's time, obviously resources, right? But it's consistency. He never stopped doing it. So sometimes we come into this world as entrepreneurs, right? And we don't want to assign the resources needed to get there, whether that's time, whether that's money, whether that's a team, right? So we gotta recognize that. Once we recognize that, you have the freedom to start creating. Like you said, it's not about the background. I mean, we had a... We used to have like that New York picture in here that came with our office, right? And you know, one of our clients is like, I'm sending you guys a present, and this is why we have this background, right? But if it was for us, when we started the show, it was in this little corner with like two white walls, and then we just had like this little superhero kind of deal that we love. And we're like, here we go. Guess what, right? For us, that's who we are. And we had a, we learned our lesson where we gotta be who we are to be able to be happy doing this thing, right? So if I'm pretending that I'm not this person, and then I ended up with a big client or a big project that I have to pretend all the time, it's not gonna work out, because that happened to us. So we're like, you know what? Whoever like really, really resonates with us, with our energy, with what we do, with a Green Ranger helmet, with the colors and whatever, and they smile, that's our people. That's the people that we wanna hang out with. So we use it as a filter to do that. And at the beginning, we might be scared that I might be losing on some other people, right? Because I am not X, right? Doesn't matter. You're going to find your own people. And we've seen it, right? We connected with incredible entrepreneurs like Steve Sims, like Todd Brown, Mike Koenig yesterday. He was an advisor for Tony Robbins, right? Like, you're like, what? Like, what incredible entrepreneurs? Just being yourself, right? So, and you know, to your point on the backgrounds or the platform, we had a client who works with us, and he comes to us and he's like, I want to start publishing. We were promoting the 45 Live at the time. We're about to launch the challenge with about 100 people, right? And he comes, and he's not from the US, right? He's from South America, and he was transitioning jobs in the corporate world, and he was very, very, very concerned that the quality of what he was producing, as in how it looks, was not up to par, because he was always on corporate and he didn't have the resources to invest in a studio, in an equipment. So we're like, okay, do you know what you talk about? And he's like, I don't know what I want to talk about. And I'm like, sounds good. Let's start with like remove all the frictions and start talking to the camera, right? So we gave him that framework. We gave him, hey, just tell a story, and then relate it to something, a lesson, right? Like, he wanted to go the leadership route, right? And like, relate it to a lesson that you want to teach people. So he started doing that. He was very scared that he was not able to talk enough, right? He asked, like, what's the perfect time? And it's like, perfect time is like what you can execute right now, whether that's a minute, 30 seconds, like, hey guys, I'm here, I'm very nervous, I'm gonna start doing this for the next 45 days. Thank you, see you tomorrow. Like, that's enough, right? For the first time. Well, the first video he spoke for about 30 minutes, right? So we're like, okay, you have no issue doing this thing. And then as he evolved, he found his message, he found his core pillars of what he wanted to talk about, you know, values, family, different things, right? He was able to get feedback from the audience that was tuning in, because he was being himself outside doing workouts and different things, right? And guess what? He was able to actually sell a product after 45 days, right? Of a solution that their audience told him to do. And I'm like, see, there it is. Like, you were able to do that. Now, how can you take it to the next level? So he decided, right? He decided, because he loves having conversations, to launch a show, to launch a podcast, right? Same thing happened, right? His podcast, or his platform, we call it platform, right? It's just on Facebook Live, right? But people don't know that. Like, it doesn't matter, because the focus is the relationship. As soon as like you capitalize on that relationship, and for him was corporate trainings, he was able to land and work with companies with 200 salesmen, and he was able to do a workshop for those 200 salesmen very shortly after launching the show. Just on Facebook, like, you don't need all the platforms at first, but guess what? You're gonna get resources, and because this thing is working, we gotta reinvest those resources into that thing that's working. So then you can level up your level of production, right? We're lucky because we invested in equipment very early, right? The story I told you, but that was sitting in the closet, and with 45 Live, it was just our phones, right? And it landed us one of the biggest clients. So that perception, right, that we have, or that false belief, we got to get rid of it, and we got to just start executing, right? And start small, right? You could do one video. It could be like 3 videos a week. It could be like 1 video a day. Like, how fast do you want to put in the reps? And things will happen. Like, good things will happen. I promise.
I think, I mean, I love that answer, but you know, I think it's around, my motto is always imperfect action. Like, just do it and you'll figure it out along the way. But to kind of start planning this whole thing, you'll never get done. In a year's time, you're still not going to have started it. I mean, and I think the beautiful thing about whether it's Facebook Live, whether it's a podcast or whatever, is in the beginning, no one's listening to you. I mean, I my first podcast, I think there's 3 views, of which 1 is myself and 2 is my mother and 1 is my fiance, 4. So it's like, it doesn't really matter. And it did go well. And it just gives you confidence to do the next one and the next one. And I mean, sure, you guys had the same trajectory. But now it's a culmination of those years that people didn't see that's now blowing up. But people are a little bit scared to put in that hard work in the beginning.
Yeah. that's why we go back to do something that you really enjoy. You know, we were on a call and you're right on the money, right? Like we were on a call with this lady, and for us, podcasting, the platform of having interviews like this is where we shine, is what we love to do, right? We're like always, all these ideas of different shows in different niches is like, oh my gosh, we want to learn NFTs. Let's create a show about NFTs and build relationships there, right? Like, is that kind of deal? We're talking about a soccer show. Like, how can that evolve into a newsletter, into different things, right? But this lady, she had a flower shop, right? And all the brides will go in and pick all the flowers for their weddings, right? And she goes, well, you know, for either 45 Live or a podcast, like, why would I talk about a podcast? People get so hung up in the tactics, in the thing, right? And I'm like, let's think framework, right? Framework publishing. What will be your platform? And we start asking questions. We're like, how are you comfortable sharing your content, right? Your thoughts, right? And she's like, well, you know, for the store or really me, like I've really lived in Instagram all my life, right? Like I don't really know other platforms. I'm like, sounds good. Well, learning those platforms, is that going to add friction to your day? Like, are you going to have to carve out time to do this? Are you going to enjoy it? And she's like, not really. And I'm like, sounds good. Don't even think about that right now, right? Like that's going to come later. I'm like, okay, let's focus on just Instagram, right? So what do you do during the day in the shop? Well, you know, we had these customers coming in and they're looking at the flowers, and then we're building the setups, right? And people, when they come into the store, they really love it. And that's how we build that relationship. And then that turns into a sale, right? And we're like, sounds good. Now you can do that digitally as well, right? So instead of you talking about the types of flowers, because, you know, on your phone, if that's your thing, awesome. Go ahead and do it. Test it. See if it works, right? For us, like, I have no idea about flowers, so I would not do that. So I would just, like, maybe share stories of your clients. Like, hey, you know, how did the wedding go? Or show the behind the scenes on how you guys build those setups. Show the new flowers arriving. Show what's happening in the store every single day. And she really liked that because it didn't add any friction into her day-to-day, because she was walking around doing her thing and she was documenting, right? We hear Gary Vee say it all the time, document, 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 right? It's because of that. It's remove the friction. So, you know, for those listening, I really want you to think about your day, like, and what are the stories? What are the things that are happening that you can relate to your business? Can you show something behind the scenes? Can you show this? Like, it depends on the business, right? If I show the behind the scenes of what happens at Bizro, it's just going to be very boring because it's a lot of work behind a computer. So I'm like, hey guys, I'm here working behind the computer, right? I'm communicating with the team. And maybe some people want to see that, right? But for us, right, the show is a thing. Maybe people have asked us, say, how do you guys run the show, right? We do 3 live shows every single week. People are like, wow. And we even thought about doing 5. And we're like, and people are like, wow, like I cannot even keep up with 1. Can you guys show us how to do it? And that's where the opportunities come, because you're like, sweet. Yes, absolutely. I can help you. So yeah, find what you enjoy first to like get unstuck. And then as you get momentum, you're going to start figuring out ideas are going to be coming in, and it's going to be a really fun process.
Yeah. Well, funny you mentioned that, we actually, you know, my fiance is a physiotherapist, so we're trying to up her Instagram. And it's exactly that. It's not that you're trying to reinvent the wheel. It's just documenting that, you know, you help this client do something like this. And people like to see that, because they also want to see you as the expert to say, listen, I've got that problem, I'm coming to you. So it's exactly like you said, just document what's going on during your day. There's an interest in it. If it doesn't work, you're quickly going to find it out and tweak it.
Absolutely. Yep.
So coming to the end, I have to ask you what you think of Ronaldo playing for Man United this afternoon or later today.
I think it's wonderful, man. I think he's going back home to Old Trafford, and he's gonna have a good time, man. And you know, mind you, they needed something like that in the last few seasons. I'm not a Premier League fan. Like, I follow it, I love it. I'm a Barca fan since '99 when Rivaldo made that bicycle kick goal against Valencia. That's where I started. But my brother is an Arsenal fan, so he's not having the best time of his life right now because they're last in the table. So, and I think they played today, but
yeah, just send him our well wishes, man.
we will, yeah.
So, I think the one thing that I'd like to ask, and I always like to show people on the show, is in terms of funnels and what's working for current entrepreneurs that are successful in their certain niches. what funnel setup are you guys using in terms of bringing in customers and kind of sending them through your, you know, your process?
Yeah, that's a really good question, and I love this. So if you actually, if today, this might change in the next few weeks, but if you go to bizbros.co, you will see a sales letter that we wrote about maybe 4 years ago, right? And we got told many times that you cannot sell anything if you don't have a website. And so that was our belief for a long time, right? And you know, we've been in the funnel game, we've built funnels before and different things. And that sales letter has to stay there. And people, when they go there, they're very confused. The reason there is there is to show a different approach that we've taken that is evolving. And I'll tell you what is evolving too. But at first, we didn't have the resources to build a funnel. We didn't know how to build a funnel, right? Like, there's a lot of people out there that are very confused. So if they have people like you that are like really experts at this, like, please reach out. Because like, we were there, right? We were those guys that are trying to figure out, and it was challenging. So we put that page in there. It got us a couple leads. But what we did is, like, the funnel, right, is us. The funnel is the show, right? So people get very confused, like, where a sales funnel is, it has to be a website. Like, for us, we didn't start there. We started with us. So we're like, okay, we qualify. There's a pool of people that produces shows, right? Or our dream client. And then from there, some of those qualify to be on the show, for example, and then, or referrals come in to be on the show. And then we build that relationship. So keep that in mind as a framework. But as you evolve, that will change, right? So what we're doing now is, because with the service, we started just with content multipurposing. There's different layers to that. And then there's other stuff that people have been requesting, like podcast producing and different things. So there's a couple of partnerships that we just finalized. We have a big event at the end of the month. So that's probably going to launch there. But what we're doing is, each service has their own page. But people are like, the market that we live in, people always want to know, what do you do? So we are building basically a hub where it shows all the stuff that we do. And then if they're interested, right, they raise their hand, they're going to come in. And each one of them is going to have their own setup where individually we can be like, okay, this is the service, this is what you need, X, Y, Z. And then you can build it up as a Lego, right? Like, well, I need the podcast production, I need the content multi-purpose, and depending on the need, depending on where they sit, depending on their resources. So that's the direction we're going. We're big fans of video sales letters. So there's one for the Content Momentum that we haven't released yet. It's so good, but we haven't done it yet. Is because the show has been carrying the whole thing, right? So for us, it's good. And then we're about to go to the next level. So that's probably why we're going to now have that as a support to the show.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's such a nice setup. We've done it for a guy on YouTube as well. They kind of had a funnel hub with all these different things. But it sounds really interesting that they can kind of piece these different puzzles together, which is kind of a custom deal for each client. That's pretty cool. So I think the last thing is if someone wants to work with you, is it bizbro.co where they can get hold of you?
Well, bizbro.co is going to send them to that old website. So they can go check it out. But social media is the best way. So you can search on Facebook or Instagram at bizbrosco. You can also go to contentisprofit.com and drop us a line there. We're always, you know, it's us behind social media. So go and send us your favorite emoji. And I know that you're coming here from Guyland. So, and we'll chat. Any questions you might have about content, if you are into communities and Facebook, we do have a Facebook group as well where we jump on live and we interact with a lot of people. All the shows are streaming there as well. So it's facebook.com/contentisprofit. Very simple. Contentisprofit everywhere. You'll find us.
Yeah, you can't miss them. So. I mean, if you can tune into their shows, it's like, as I said, it's such high energy. It's like a dope. It's like drinking. It's like listening to coffee, if that makes sense. So, yeah, Luis, I just want to thank you for being on and just, you know, the value that you've brought. It's just great hearing from people like you. And we appreciate your time on the weekend. So thank you for coming on. And thank you to everyone listening. We will see you guys next time.
Thank you, Alan. It's a pleasure. Bye.